is B. E. Schwab, and I'm here for the conclusion of the Shades of Magic trilogy. Woo! Woo!
Hi, my name is Erika Lewis, and I'm here for actually day one. This just came on sale today.
I'm Kim Ligett. I'm here for The Last Harvest of the Horror Girl.
She writes about blood. Hi, I'm Susan Dennard. I'm the author of the Something Strange and Deadly trilogy, as well as the Witchlands series. So which came out like a month ago, so thanks for coming!
My book is about a guy named Ethan Mackay, who's a freshman at Venice High School, and he makes a tragic mistake, and because of that, his mother's kidnapped, and it's all his fault. So he has to go on a really long mission to find her. I should set up that Ethan is plagued by the curse, as people said, of seeing ghosts, something his psychotically overprotective mother refuses to allow him to talk about. And he's also not allowed out of the house with her to go anywhere with her. So as you can imagine, when we meet Ethan, he is ready to bolt, and then he does, which sets up the entire journey that he's going on. And the mythology in the story, although it's completely modern day, is Irish Celtic mythology.
The Shades of Magic series is about a magician named Kalmaresh with the ability to travel between multiple versions of London, officially as a messenger and unofficially as a smuggler. And he comes into possession of something he absolutely should not have, and before he can get rid of it, he gets his pocket picked by a cross-dressing thief named Delilah Bard. Picks up exactly where Gathering of Shadows leaves off to the second, so it's basically the most spoiler-ridden book in the world, so that's why I just pitched the beginning of the series.
Isn't that the coolest thing ever? It's amazing how different our books are, but yet we both...
Right? Like Harry Potter and Avatar, and like the two things you got are the Shades of Magic series and the Witchlands.
Forever.
Yes!
Anywho, so The Witchlands is like my love letter to Zutara, and not really. There maybe are hints of that, but I'm so frustrated when that series ended. What is it about? How many of you guys have read Truth Witch? Should I pitch the first book? We'll go with the first book. Okay. Truth Witch is about two best friends, our titular Truth Witch, Truth and Lie, which, as you might imagine, is very valuable magic to have. It's also very rare, and so she's kept it secret her whole life. But in the opening scene, a mercenary blood witch sniffs out what she is and decides to go after her for the bounty. So she and her best friend are like, oh no, and set off on this epic journey across the Witchlands, and we have three empires that are about to go to war, magic is also dying, and the two best friends, as they learn, may or may not be the chosen pair meant to save it all. The Avatar.
That's hard to follow. It's not about Avatar. This takes place in a really small town in Oklahoma where everything centers around like football, church, and farming. And what better place for the devil, honestly. So it really is, the first line of the book is, can I even remember this? I can. But it kind of sums it up perfectly. People call this God's country, but you can't have God without the devil. And that is this book. And it's my love letter to growing up during the Satanic Panic. And I don't know if any of you guys are familiar with that, but
yes.
Okay, in a tiny town, it was a big deal. Like, anything that went wrong, it was Satan. I mean, the girl ran off with her boyfriend. It was sad. And so this book really deals with like if it's real or if it's not, and it's scary and it's bloody, and it's a big mystery. So if you like unraveling things, it has a huge shock ending. So if you like to unravel threads and you like blood, this is the one.
I just want to say, I can't hear the word Satan normally. My husband is French and he pronounces it Satin every time. And it makes me laugh now. I don't know. No, that's not how we say it. You don't sound scary. Anyway, so Satin. There can't be God without Satin.
Because my answer here is very simple. I believe in having the fewest rituals possible, because the more rituals you have, the more excuses you have not to write, right? So like the more contingencies you have in effect, the easier it is to excuse yourself from the task at hand. So for me, I try to create as minimal and like a necessary experience as possible. I have white noise like in my headphones, and I have a cup of tea at my side. And as long as I have those two things, I can be in any city, any country, anywhere, and do my work.
My ritual is to just kick my husband and children out of the house first thing in the morning. and that they have to go to school, so it works out really well. And then I'm pretty much writing all day until I get to my hourly break when I like to go for a run to work out all this crazy stuff that I hadn't been able to work out while I was sitting there. So that's pretty much my entire ritual.
Yeah, I can get in those patterns, like you're talking, like I can really delve into those crazy patterns if I let myself, but I do try and get away and write a lot. A lot of people, I don't know if anybody follows me on Instagram, but I do try to get away and do writing retreats with friends and things like that. We went to a haunted mansion last week. It was pretty great. But I wrote like a boss there. So. I do try to mix it up because I know how I am. You know, I can get really deep into all that. So I'm working on it. I'm working on it.
Oh. Cheers. I don't really know that I have a ritual lately. It's just like abject fear when I come to my office. Windwitch broke me. In case you follow me online, you already know. And what I do like to do, though, I have like sacred time in the morning. And it is like first thing in the morning when my mind is freshest. I have my coffee, I have my noise canceling headphones. We are literally the same. We spent all day on the train realizing that we are the same. And then I took all of her wisdom and I'm going to try to apply it to my life. And then my dogs, I have to have them near. I don't have to have them near, but it's better when dogs are around. And then I have a big whiteboard that I rely on. This was a trick I learned last year with my editor, that like I am a very visual thinker, and I think it until I have written it, and it helps if it's big. And so in my office, I have a whiteboard, and I just spend like hours with my coffee and my noise and think very hard. A lot of her writing is thinking. I think people don't realize that, at least for me, I would say like 90% of the job is just staring and thinking really hard. And then really getting frustrated and going for a run. Or if you're me and you hate running, you're gonna die. You take your dogs for a walk, or I do martial arts, so I go to the dojo and get my face beat up. Actually, when I was here last year, guys, I had a broken nose. So for those of you who were here last year, you remember. It's still crooked. I never got it fixed. That's my ritual. Get your face broken.
A lot of debate over this. I did a lot of research into cattle breeding, and in particular semen guns, and that was a weird rabbit hole. I don't really like to talk about it, and I can't believe I just said that here.
I don't think on a panel of authors in the history of ever somebody said the word semen guns.
said it twice.
Breaking boundaries, Kim.
Sorry, it's a thing.
Well, this whole book is set in Irish Celtic mythology, but there were some really strange things that you had to research when you started delving into it. Like, people talk about dungeons, and dungeons are always in the movies under the castle and dark, gritty places, but actually most of them were towers and round. And they had two purposes. They were actually to hide not only the people that lived in the castle, the king and the queen, whatever, when it was invaded. So it went in there, but then it was also a place where you stored prisoners. So like the Tower of London has beautiful areas and has parts that are torture rooms. So they're all in one thing, so that's kind of funny.
My parents' house has dungeons.
Surprises nobody. Right? Like prison cells underneath the garden wall and everything, right? I know how to roll. It does explain a lot about me. This is a tricky thing because obviously most of it is fantasy, and aside from like finding really cool knives. Like Lila has a favorite knife in the series, and essentially it's a dagger that has a hilt, like a knuckled hilt. So you could punch someone or you could stab someone. You can't do both at the same time, which bothers her. But like you can't do both. And that's a real knife in the Edinburgh Police Museum. Like it hangs on a wall. The Edinburgh Police Museum is this super morbid place. It has like skin purses from like Burke and Hare, the grave robbers, and also this knife. And the moment I saw the knife on the wall, I was like, Lila. And I took a picture of it. And like a year later, it was in the book. No, the only really weird thing I had to research was. This is obviously like set geographically in London, and so I had to walk Kel's paths through Grey London and through Red London, and I remember one day like walking it with a friend being like, do you think you could drag a body across this bridge? Like, how conscious does Kel need to be for Lila to drag him across the bridge? And Mugwan, right, is a really long bridge. And so that was probably, like, people were always like, where did you stretch the bounds of reason in this book? None of the magic, right? The only stretching of bounds of reason in this book is that Lila would be able to drag this half-conscious Kel across one of the bridges of London, and it still bothers me, but I needed her to do it. So I'm like, she's just really strong, and Kel is kind of conscious.
I just want to throw out there self-defense tip. If you're ever grabbed, personally, go full no bones.
Yeah.
Go, like, relax. No one can hold on to you. It's something we learn immediately in early self-defense. You can't hit. People can't hold on to you. They're expecting you to tense up, which makes it easier to hold on to. And I went dark. Sorry. Just in case, you know, if you're ever in one of our books. I didn't know. What's my research? So with my first series, which is set in the 1870s, I came across this like cool, ridiculous thing. Back then, I'm gonna have to display it, sorry. Back then, you had these dresses, right? The corsets. Forget that. Susan, breaking everything. Breaking everything since 2017. So you had your corset and you had your bustle, and it was really uncomfortable and like not good for your spine. So women often would like stand kind of like this all the time. And they decided to call it a pose because men thought it was erotic. It was called the Grecian bend, and like you were forced to. You were always like, and you made that noise. And so I read that and I was like, oh my gosh, I'm putting that in a book. So there's a scene where her mom has brought her to like a parlor and she's really wanting her to get with this eligible bachelor. So she's mouthing across the room, Grecian bend, do your Grecian bend. Eleanor, the main character, is like, uh-uh. That was the weirdest, most random thing I ever saw. Yeah, now you're gonna do it, right?
No.
It's erotic.
So I have no deleted scenes because of my, like, but this is about to get, there's still an answer here. No, there's still an answer. So I always, my drafts are really thin and then I have to bulk them up. But I fought through three straight books to name a character Zebedee. because I was obsessed with this name, right? I feel like my editor somewhere just went, oh god. But yeah, so like I like desperately wanted Edward Archibald Tuttle III, aka Ned, my like one little human who just really wants to be a magician. I wanted to name him Zebedee so bad, and I have no good reason for it. I just became obsessed with the name, and my editor hates that name. I know, right? She's just shaking her head over there. She
literally came up from the back.
She hates the name so much.
It's unspellable.
It's not unspellable to me, but now for every manuscript for the rest of my life, I'm going to name something or someone Zebedee just until she's not so that I can have it, because I miss my Zebedee. I was really obsessed with that name. I don't know why. It's a horrible name. But I became quite attached to it, and I've never got to have it. So now one day, when my editor's not paying enough attention, I will name a character or an animal or something Zebedee.
Well, I write the complete opposite. Mine is way too long when I turn it in. I'm getting better at editing myself. Every line is brilliant, right? What do you think of that? So, actually, one of my characters, Ethan's cousin, Christian McKay, used to have a little sister. And as Elaine and I were editing the manuscript, there were lots of scenes with poor Edna, and one day I just am like, I am sorry. I think she's gotta go, and I felt so bad about this. And Elaine sends me an email back, literally with a gift, which is just literally a brother taking a sister and literally kicking her out. And I'm like, oh God, she's dead now. But so there was that character that got next. And then there was actually a whole chapter, because there's a character named Captain Bartlett who, sadly for him, got stuck being Ethan's bodyguard, which was no fun in LA because Ethan was so sarcastic and obnoxious and took off and messed everything up. He was gone for 14 years, and he missed his grandkids being born, he missed his daughter getting married. And so although there is still a lot of him in there in the chapter specifically with his daughter, the actual reunion of the two of them, when they came home, I had written that chapter, and we were just running out of space in the novel. So the good news is for you guys, it's actually up, and I can't remember which blog, that asked me for a deleted scene, so I actually gave them the whole chapter, so you guys can read it.
I'm like you, I write really lean, so I have mom always have you like breathe, into the pages later. But I do something kind of interesting that I don't think I've ever said before, but with Blood and Salt, which is my first book, none of that was the same. I mean, the book that I wrote it's not the finished book. I mean, everything was thrown out at least 8 times. So, yeah. And so, and I still felt like I had something to say. And so that's where The Lost Harvest stemmed from, is I had something very specific that I wanted to say, and Tor, honestly, like, I don't know another company who would give me that much room and that much breathing space to be able to write a book like that, which is really like old school 80s slasher horror, So they really gave me all the room in the world to be creative and to do what I wanted, and really respected my vision. And I said what I have to say. There will be no more crops in my books. So, no, I have lots more books, but no more with crops. Wheat. I'm ending with wheat.
Hogging them one over here. Cutscenes. I'm sorry, we get to the end and I'm listening and I forget what the original question was. So I write very strangely in that I write out of order and then assemble my books like a puzzle. And so I'm hesitant to ever use cutscenes because they might be used in a later book. So it may not be in this book, but I don't want to use it because it might show up in the next one. I do have one scene that you can read for free that I cut from Truth Witch with the Blood Witch, and I loved that scene so much, but it was long, we needed to tighten the book, and it didn't necessarily add that much to the plot, so we cut it out, and I used that, you can wedge some of that key information elsewhere, which is what I did, but I loved that scene, I did. And now I regret, using it as extra content, because I'm like, crap, I could've used it in the later book, what was I doing, I love this scene, so lesson learned, you will never get extra content again.
I was just gonna say, we both write intensely out of order, like down to paragraphs within the scene are all out of order, and you never know. Like, you never know when you might actually find a use for it, so I just have the file of things which like the cut lines, which I will then stitch into something else later on.
Thank God for Scrivener, because it's so hard to keep track of without it.
Yeah.
I actually have an answer for that one. So the first scene that I thought of in Witch Lands, I knew I wanted to write a book about friends, and I wanted to write a book of magic and set in an alternate sort of Croatia Adriatic world, but I didn't have that opening scene yet, and you need to incubate, like ideas have to sit and grow, and so I was waiting for that idea and the gray matter back here to finally come forth into the front of my head and want to be written. And I heard, do you guys know Two Steps from Hell, the composition duo, was the greatest thing ever. Look it up when you get home. You will never love any music more. And if you do, don't tell me. So I heard their song El Dorado, and like suddenly the scene was just there. It was playing in my head. And that's like one of the scenes that changed the least in that book, and the first line is, everything had gone horribly wrong. And that was the first thing I thought of. I was like, oh gosh, everything has gone horribly wrong. And it had, and so it was the two girls, they're trying to hold up this carriage, and as the carriage rolls up, they realize it's the wrong carriage. And now they're committed, and they can't turn back, and they gotta hold up this carriage that is not the one they wanted, and it's heavily guarded, and there's this blood witch there, and you can smell what their magics are, so. Thus begins our adventure, because everything had gone horribly wrong.
I had, it's amazing how long these ideas take to grow.
Yeah.
And for years, you know, I had this image of this kid on a combine, you know, in the wheat field. And I grew up in the Midwest from a tiny town in Kansas, so there's something like really darkly romantic about that landscape, but I thought of the sky too, how I wanted to make the sky a character in this book, and because it was so overwhelming, you know, there in the plains, and you know, they call that open sky country for a reason, because it's like it's going to swallow you whole. But I wrote the first chapter of this book just straight through, and it was never edited. I mean, it was that precise, and once I had that, and I had that opening chapter, I knew exactly what this character and where I was going, and it was just kind of magic. I hope it happens again. It was really fun.
Cause, especially a kid in high school who looks like he's talking to himself in a complete nutcase because he's not talking about it, and then he tries all kinds of music in his own, to anything, Led Zeppelin, anything really loud, because it usually works and gets rid of them, and then it doesn't get rid of them. And bullies are tormenting him, and so in my brain I had this whole thing worked out from all of my creepy, crazy experiences with ghosts. As a kid, I grew up in a Civil War town, and so I used to wander the graveyards.
Yeah.
And I just sort of sit there and talk to them, even though I'm hoping none of them actually heard me and are following me now. So, you know, it was sort of an obsession of mine, and the feeling of the cold and how that would amplify 1,000 times. And So I didn't see the entire scene in my head, but I wrote, Ethan had written a letter of apology to his mother that I had sort of, you know, that was my thing that I kept with me every time I was writing a scene of him feeling so incredibly upset and sad that he had done this to her. And so that was sort of the story.
The first scene, I have a very long incubation period as well for my stories, and about a year before I started writing A Darker Shade of Magic, I had an idea in my head, just a crystal clear image of a young man in a fabulous coat, of course, of a young man in a coat walking through a wall and colliding with a girl dressed as a boy. And I knew nothing else about it except for that, and it would be another 6 months before I realized I wanted to write a book about magic and parallel worlds, and I realized that that young man was walking through a wall between worlds and not a wall between rooms, and I realized who the girl was, and all of these pieces started coming together, and that's now, I think, chapter 13 of Darker Shade of Magic. I don't have the book in front of me, so I can't check it, but it's Kel and Lila's primary collision. It's the instigating act of the entire series, and it was the very first one. The first scenes of the books are very rarely the first ones that come to me, coming from writing out of order, but usually the most important scene of the book is the one that I write first. Gathering of Shadows was unusual because Delilah Bard floating in the middle of an ocean in a two-person skiff with her hands tied. That was the first scene that I had because I knew we had to open that book with Delilah Bard getting into, and then things went terribly wrong kind of territory. But yeah, Darker Shade of Magic was completely born out of this still frame in my mind of the two main characters colliding.